This week, three sides of the coin. I don't know what the heck we're talking about. It's a million different questions you guys sent us.
Doormats.
Huh? What'd you say?
Doormats.
Doormats. Doormats. It still hasn't arrived. The doormats still haven't arrived.
We should have like a count, like a day counter in the corner.
How many days has it been since doormats haven't arrived?
Like they did during the '70s when the Iranian hostages were there. They had to count.
That's what I was saying. Day 181.
We're gonna start asking all of our listeners to start tying ribbons around trees.
Blue ones, like the bat color.
All right, three sides of the coin this week. Lots of fun. Don't miss the show.
This is Three Sides of the Coin, talking all things KISS.
I want to rock and roll all night.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
So you love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. I am one of your three co-hosts, Michael Branvold, and as always, I'm joined by Tommy Summers and Mark Cicchini.
Woohoo!
This is kind of our holiday party show, so I thought I would festively dress up again and... Woohoo!
It's a $3 bill, baby.
Thank God we only have to see that every couple of months. Jesus.
So we actually we're pulling somebody up from the bullpen, Lisa, but she's running a little late, so we thought we'd get started without her and get some of the crap out of the way. I want to remind everybody, all merchandise in the Three Sides of the Coin store is on sale this month. 20% off everything through the end of this month. Both t-shirts, the Shocker t-shirt and the original logo t-shirt and the hat are all 20% off. Head over to shop.threesidesofthecoin.com. We take credit cards. We ship worldwide. Do it.
Do those include the used Tommy Summers undies? I mean, or is that just the extra dark or the
that's
after
dark? That's the after dark show store. And I want, so we're kind of clearing out inventory because next year we all want to do a new shirt. And I think we're going to do the rock and roll over image shirt with us on it. But we just made an arrangement. So at some point starting later this month, and I'll tell everybody right now, later this month, every order that you place with KISSmuseum.com, you're going to get a brand new Three Sides of the Coin, 3-inch square, rock and roll over graphic sticker.
Cool.
So that's not available anywhere else right now. I don't even have them. I just printed them up and they were sent directly to KISS Museum. So once they get in stock, I'll let everybody know, but it'll probably be another week or so before they're in stock at KISS Museum. They said they would love to give one free sticker with every order. So,
great, and then you guys can put it on your back window.
There you go. So big shout out to KISS Museum for doing that. All right, so that's it for housekeeping. Tommy.
Sorry.
Got any comments you want to share?
No, because I'm extremely ill-prepared because I have like freaking 40 pages of questions. And I was gone yesterday because I was at the Alice Cooper Motley Crue show in Sioux Falls. So
by the way, those pictures, Tommy, wow, they were dynamite.
Thank you.
I mean, it does not look like a hobby. That looked like a profession. I'm seriously.
Oh, thank you.
And you're doing those without photo passes from your seat in the audience, right?
Oh, of course. The photo passes just wrecks it because they limit you to a certain number of songs and they put you in a bad place. Because I've never been a big fan of those photos that are, you're looking up at someone like this, you know? I like to try to get the whole stage and stuff and frame the shot. So I just do it for fun. That's what I enjoy doing. And speaking of that, if any of you are Alice Cooper fans, please, if you get a chance, go out and support him. But do the VIP, because it's phenomenal. His staff is amazing. They are so accommodating, and Alice is such a nice guy. He will sign stuff for you, take pictures, the whole nine yards. So get out there and do that. And I was at Badlands yesterday because I was in Sioux Falls, and that's the tie-in with Paul Stanley.
That's where you went.
Yes.
That place looks freaking amazing.
Yeah, they didn't play there. They actually played at the big arena across the street. But it is. It's really cool. It's like a pawn shop where they move everything out of the way for the concert. And KISS is going to be there in February.
So that, okay. All right. So, because I've been following the Badlands, how they've been building this for the last few months. I mean, it was built from nothing.
Yep.
We actually, you and I met one of the guys who works with that at when we were in Vegas.
Yeah, and he came up and talked to me.
Oh,
and
cool.
Reintroduced himself, and again, it was like right when I was going in to see Alice.
Cool.
I'm like,
the Badland things looks very, very cool. Yeah, they built this. I thought they built a separate pawn shop and an arena. So what you're saying is it's all one building, and they roll everything from the pawn shop out, and that becomes the arena for shows?
Yeah, because the stage is always set up. So if you remember, like, the Mirage in Minneapolis, maybe that was after
Yeah,
your
that
time.
Was after me.
Okay, but yeah, it's a huge, it's a big building, and literally even the counters where they have the jewelry are on wheels, so they can just literally move everything out of the way.
Wow, so freaking cool.
And again, super nice staff there too as well, and they don't have a ton of stuff for sale. It's more merchandise right now, like the Badlands t-shirts and stuff, and they have, you know, instruments. They have lots of guitars for sale, and gold and jewelry and that type of thing. But it's not like the traditional pawn shop where you go in there and there's
I mean, I think what I've been following is for the last few months, they've just been buying stuff to sort of stock the pawn shop with guns and jewelry.
Yep.
And then once the pawn shop opened, it's become a legit pawn shop. So you can go in there and pawn stuff, but they needed to have some inventory to open. And they only opened on Thanksgiving. That's when they first opened.
It is so cool, and boy, do they have a lineup. And they've got so many great acts coming in, and it's really affordable tickets, like $50 to see Joan Jett, you know.
That's where KISS
Tom
is going to do a full acoustic show up there in February.
Yep,
that's
yep. And they're going to be $175.
That's in North Dakota.
Sioux Falls, South Dakota.
Okay.
It's just across the border from Minnesota. It's about like a three-hour drive from Minneapolis. And so they had also, too, before I forget, they have the premier magazine for the Badlands that features KISS on the cover.
Oh, Mark needs one.
Really nice. Yeah, I snagged a couple.
I swear to God, I thought you were going to reach over and pick one up and show it to us. Like, I already got it.
Well, I do. I've got it out in my truck. I just forgot to bring it in.
Well, go get it.
Busted! Good one. That was good. Oh, I couldn't have scripted that any better.
Oh my
God,
funny.
That was good. I mean, check out the Badlands Golden Pawn Shop on Facebook. They also just launched a legit terrestrial radio station, KBAD. And, like, Ron Keel is, like, one of the DJs in the afternoon there. Ron Keel.
Oh, okay.
Seriously, I mean, what they're doing is so freaking cool up there. I'm looking at that going, God, it's Sioux Falls, South Dakota. That's a haul to get out there. But if you're in the Midwest, upper Midwest, you got to go check this place out. And like Tommy said, the lineup for the next, like, the first 3 or 4 months of shows – they've got serious acts coming through there.
I just
really
cannot
great.
Wrap my head around that concept. Who would have thought to put a pawn shop and a music theater together? That just, it just doesn't seem like it would make a lot of sense.
But the way they're doing it, it's working out great. Jeez, how many did you steal, Tommy? What are you, a freaking KISS fan?
Borrowed.
Okay.
How many did you steal?
I grabbed a whole pile of them because I thought we could give some away to our listeners.
He's such a freaking KISS fan.
I love it.
Yeah.
All right, I need that bad.
Yeah, and it's high gloss. It's like a thick, heavy cardboard type cover, and it says souvenir premiere issue Badlands Monthly. Hold KISS on. Really? Yep. Yeah, and so they do, you know.
Oh wow.
There's, it's really sweet. So I picked up a couple for both of you guys. I thought maybe Lisa would want one, and then I've got a few extras. So in case we wanted, like, do.
All right. So first of all, Mark doesn't get one until the doormats arrive.
Fuck.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. It's a great.
Sorry, magazine. Mark, but that's a legit claim.
Yeah, it's reasonable. So yeah, there's some really cool KISS stuff in here, and then it talks about the making of the place and all that. So I knew there'd be a bunch of people who listen to us that are hardcore KISS fans that won't be able to make it to Badlands. So I grabbed a pile.
You rock, Tommy. So yeah. Lisa just messaged me. She's ready. Let's pause for a minute. We'll get Lisa online, and then we'll begin with the show.
Okay.
Cool.
All right.
Take three sides of the coin with you anywhere. Download your 5-star rated free smartphone app today and listen on your Android or Apple smartphone. Visit android.threesidesofthecoin.com or ios.threesidesofthecoin.com.
Yeah. All right. Thank you for joining us, Lisa. I mean, we sent out the call to the bullpen, 2 weeks ago? And you're 20
still
minutes
couldn't
late.
Get here on time.
Exactly.
It takes a while to get, you know. I just ran in the door from work.
Listen, you know. Does Mark put makeup on for us? Hell no.
Look at the after dark.
I don't know if I ever want to see that. I just...
The After Dark? I think that'd be awesome.
Powder do you want to see Mark in KISS makeup in a blue Speedo After Dark?
Powder blue.
He could wear one of those slings. You know those slings? Those like...
Ah!
Slings?
Izzy was wearing that picture.
Hey, Lisa, have you seen my t-shirt?
That is awesome.
No, it's not.
Wait, Mark, you look so good in that picture.
I had to pull this out to
fans. I'm doing my Charles Nelson Reilly laugh.
For the five of you who know that who that is.
Exactly.
God. I apologize for my lateness.
All right. Well, you know, sorry. We may need to get somebody else in the bullpen when we need somebody like now. Like when it's the bottom of the ninth and we've got to finish the game. We can't wait.
You know, when we're off the air, Lisa, we have a name for the person who's last, and which I'll share with you when we're done.
We don't want to open that can of worms.
It's a kid. That would be a big can of worms.
Can of worm. We had plenty of can of worms last week.
Oh, that was awesome.
Alex was great.
Oh, that was awesome.
Alex was freaking awesome.
It was cracking me up. He was very funny.
Yeah, he's a good guy. He's a lot of fun to be with. It's funny, too, because my friend Joe and I, it was what a guy I used to travel with at the conventions. We still call CDs. We call them CDs. To this day, that's what we say, because that's the way Alex used to say it, or still does, actually. So,
yeah, that was a great, that was awesome episode. Very, very cool. I liked hearing his stories.
Lots of, we love trashing Vinny.
Oh, we're not trashing Vinny. We're getting to the truth. We're getting to the stuff that you're not going to hear anywhere else.
Mark, your wig's a little crooked, Mark.
That was the best story. His wife goes. That's awesome.
Oh, man.
It's funny. Like I told my wife, I said, mine starts going. It's just all coming off.
Listen, that's why I shaved. I basically shaved my head. It's like once it starts going, just shave it. And I got to tell you, shaving is, you know, it's the best thing I did. But I wish to God, and I swear to God, and Lisa will probably get a kick out of this. I asked my wife, she's been a hairstylist before, I go, so now that I've shaved my head, isn't there like something I can put on my head to seal it from stopping to grow back now permanently? Because as a guy, it's bad enough I got to freaking shave. I don't want to shave my head all the time.
You just have to just keep going around.
Yeah, I'm just lazy. I'm just lazy. It's just like, can I get the nice smooth gloss finish and just shellac
buff it to a high gloss shine.
My brother does the same thing, and he just says, I want to put like a nice clean shellac on it, like a little shellac
on
it.
That's what I want to do. I mean, I would keep it close, clean shaven all the time. It's just, I'm freaking lazy. I don't want to shave all the time.
Yes.
It is a pain in the butt.
I'm dreading that day because not only so much, probably about 15 years ago, I was working. I got hit with a metal ladder. I got a freaking scar this big on my hair.
That's manly, Mark. Come on.
You want to keep that exposed so people can see.
You know what? Because it's not KISS related, but it is funny. I got a great story about that, but we'll save that for another time. And just like I said, it's pretty crazy stuff.
All right, because these other two knuckleheads have to be out quicker than normal because Tommy's got a show and Mark's got a birthday to go to.
And don't blame it on me for being 5 minutes late.
KISS fans don't.
You know, Lisa, 100%.
Oh yeah,
we're not blaming any of it.
Listen, Mark's usually the one that gets the blame all the time, so he's loving the fact that he can blame somebody else today. Let's just jump right in, Tommy. This is hit and run week. This is just a fun show. So start dumping the questions on us.
Okay, I will do that. The first one that I wanted to go over, there's some that it's just like.
I thought you were prepared.
We're going to skip. I am. This one comes from Rick Friel. Why are so many KISS fans so angry?
Oh my God, there's a whole show in itself right there.
Yeah. We can get a psychologist to come on and talk about that.
I don't know. I mean, I couldn't. Because they like Ace Frehley. There you go.
They don't like change.
Yeah.
I think the whole thing is a lot of it has to do with timeline. When you jumped in, because a lot of people think KISS started when they jumped in.
True.
I think that has a lot to do with it.
I think Lisa's right, though. They just don't like change. People in general don't like change in their life.
It's common human nature.
So, you know, and good Lord, how much change has KISS gone through compared to a lot of other bands.
But you know what? That's what kept them going. You have to try to stay somewhat relevant, for the lack of a better term. And they're never going to please everybody all the time. It's impossible.
Yep.
Adapt and survive.
Okay, so next one, Chris Barreau. We all know KISS, perhaps Gene most of all, understands how merchandising is an integral part of their history. Is there any item or style that you think they have failed to meet consumer needs? As a professional 48-year-old, I find there should be, you know, I don't have the rest of it. It didn't print, but he wants to know. Sorry, he wants to know if anything didn't.
I can tell you one right now. One thing they didn't capitalize, is that basically what it is, Tommy? Something
essentially, yeah. Where did they fail to meet consumer need?
Number one, bootlegs. You should be able to go to their website and download bootlegs.
Yeah.
That's what Zappa did. You know what I mean?
He beat the boots.
You know exactly the collection I'm talking about. He took the bootleggers' vinyls, made his own, and sold them all in a package.
I was going to ask if they have to pay for it.
Eating the bootleggers.
Well, I mean, and Metallica does that now. They've got Met Club where you can get downloads of every show. But, you know, being devil's advocate again, you know, we don't know. Does KISS have the rights to do that?
Right, my point is you can get you know, either go to Universal or whoever. Because let's face it, there's a segment of the population in the KISS population that would pay $25 per show. And like I said, I listed on this show before my one favorite, and I've been getting emails about it ever since. I went through every tour and listed my favorite soundboard show from every tour. And I would bet dollars to donuts if you put that list up and you could buy it, they'd sell a ton of those.
Well, we know fans will. They did the Instant Live for the Rock the Nation tour.
Yeah.
And listen, fans were trading and buying up all of those things, but
I'm one of them.
Well, yeah, I was too. But what I heard was after that tour was over is when KISS renewed their deal with Universal. And then because of that, KISS was prohibited from selling their own live albums because Universal has the right to that.
Michael, you know, where there's a will, there's a way. And if there's cash, let's face it, they would do it.
Well, yes and no. It just means it becomes a lot more, because I've seen this with bands. If a band can make the decision and execute on something entirely on their own, it gets done and most likely will happen. The second you have to talk to the lawyer and multiple lawyers from different publishing companies and different rights holders and record labels, it just becomes this rat's nest where somebody looks back after 18 months of negotiations going, F it. It's not worth it because these lawyers just kill it.
Well, they could do then with what Mick Jagger used to do, and he'd go to the Village and sell master tapes.
Or they could just let the fans do it.
Yeah, that's what I mean. There's a will, there's a way. But yeah, I think they failed. I think they failed to give the KISS fans what they truly want, as far as live shows.
Well, and look at what happened with that movie Let It Be. You know, it's still not out because of all the lawyers. You know, so good question.
I mean, I don't know if there's any. Personally, I don't know. I mean, I do recall when I was working with them that there was a point where all of a sudden I said, you know what, let's start selling baby stuff because they hadn't done it before. And there was a little question like, really, do we want, you know, bibs and bottles? And I'm like, yeah, because you got KISS fans who are parents now. And I remember when we sold that very first bottle bib set on KISS Online, it was just people bought it. So, I mean, I think they do recognize stuff, but, you know, it's an argument you could have about any company out there releasing merchandise. I mean, you know, that's a sign of success, is how well people can stay on top of trends.
Yeah. Well, and it's got to be for everybody. You got to have a mix of different things.
I think
things.
KISS has done, overall, I think they've done pretty good.
Yeah, they seem to be on top of it, but like to Mark's point, that's where they really kind of lose out.
Yeah.
For me, you know, on some of that. All right, so next one. Rick Massman asks, I know you guys talk about Spencer's crap, but if you had to pick one thing that Spencer's released that you thought was worthy of collecting, what was it?
I know. The first original pair of Gene Simmons slipper boots that Spencer's released.
I have those.
I have a pair of them. They did two. These are the ones that are basically his Love Gun boots. They did one. They did one that was like the Dynasty boots, I think. Those were lame. Get the Love Gun ones. Those were freaking cool.
Mark, do you have any?
Well, I was going to go last, but, you know, Tommy, I have both sets.
Of course you do.
There you go.
But you don't have this yet. Just like I don't have a rug.
You know what? Out of all the stuff, and I think I said it on the show before, too, there is a banner, a Psycho Circus banner. It was promotional, and it came on a wooden stick. I want one of those.
But we're not talking promotional stuff here, Mark. We're talking products that you could buy.
He said it came from Spencer's. That's the only thing I want. What did I think that was cool that came from Spencer's? I like the four heads that hang off the wall.
Oh, those were really cool. Yep.
Sure, right over there.
the ceramic the ceramic heads.
The Vinny's Vinny head was actually real.
Yeah.
But yeah, I like those. Those are pretty cool. You know, and again, and I'm sure you guys saw the post where someone said something about Spencer's crap. Just for clarification again, guys, Spencer's crap was a term that the dealers used at the KISS Expos when someone would come up and they'd want to trade something they just bought at Spencer's. They'd want to sell it to you for $20 if they paid $10 for it. Or they'd come over with something they just bought from Spencer's, and if I had a KISS puzzle from the 70s, they'd go, well, this is a puzzle. I just don't have that one, so I want to swap. And all the dealers said the same thing. We don't want your Spencer's crap. just because we could go buy it from Spencer's, just like you just did. So why would we pay double for it? Because someone recently, within the last week, said, you know, why are you knocking the Spencer's? We're not. We're just saying it was back in the dealer days. If you got it from Spencer's, it was Spencer's crap.
There's definitely some very cool stuff from Spencer's, and I think more of it is when the first time Spencer's really released anything was really cool stuff. After Spencer's realized, and I was working with them at this time, that KISS fans were buying crap left and right. That's when they were like, "All right, well let's make a potato chip bowl and let's put the KISS logo on it and let's frickin' make a, you know." Then they started slapping the logo on everything that was a piece of crap. But the first round, I mean, that again, those slippers were really cool. I can't remember if it was the first round, but some people might say it's kind of hokey. But there was the blow up chair.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that.
That was kind of cool. I don't remember. Did the original Gene Simmons rubber costume, was that released from Spencer's as well?
I think so. I have one, too.
Yeah, I got one of those, too. I mean, it's really cool.
That's that After Dark also.
In the blow-up chair with the rubber doll.
It's this thing. It literally, it's his entire costume made of rubber.
It's his destroyer costume made of rubber. I wore it once to a office Halloween party.
Oh my function.
Frickin' God! It's like walking around in a sauna. It does not breathe at all.
Mine's still in the package.
Hey, hey, Tommy! Mark never takes his package out.
Well, yeah.
Those are for
okay, let's move on.
I never said my favorite thing.
Oh yeah, Lisa. Oh,
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Well, give me a break here, for Christ's sake.
I'm late for 5 minutes. I just leave.
Well, okay. So then, Lisa, you just have to start going first.
You got to be rude and just interrupt.
Heads out. Okay, so lay it on me.
These are my two. The KISS lamp that came out. I love the KISS lamp.
The first one. The first one was better than the second one.
The one I have is the one that has, like, I'm looking right at it, with the pillar, and it has the, Jesus.
It spins.
Go get it. Go get it. Yep, that one's cool.
I love this lamp. Usually sits on my desk at work, but it's in here now. And I like the neon sign. Remember the neon sign? The KISS neon?
What about the first lava lamp that they did?
You know what?
I thought it was lame.
I didn't buy the lava lamp, but I bought the little snow globe. And I bought the snow globe. When Spencer stuff first came out, I went crazy. I'm not going to lie. Because it was so cool to see KISS merchandise in a store. So I kind of went crazy with it. And then after time went on, it was just this like repeating the same stuff kind of. But that first run, Mike, like you said, it was just so exciting to get stuff. You know, so I bought the lamp. I have the slippers. I love the neon sign, the snow globe. Ex-boyfriend broke both of those items, so I don't have them anymore. But those are my favorite.
Bastard.
I know. Asshole.
Some people just have no respect, you know.
Bad thing is, I kept the sign. It's broken, but I still kept it. Like, I'm going to...
You'll find a KISS fan who'll buy the pieces.
Yeah.
And put it together.
I need an S. And my answer to that would be, I don't shop at Spencer's. So... But Crash Crafton, yeah. I couldn't tell you the first thing about what they've sold. All right, so Crash Crafton, regular on the show. For each of you, if KISS were to do a new studio album, what outside producer who has not produced KISS before would you like to see produce the new album? My choices would be Bob Marlette, Cameron Webb, or Bob Rock, in that order. I don't know who the first two are. So Lisa, go first.
I say Bob Rock. That's who I think.
Okay. Michael?
I've said this before in past shows, Rick Rubin.
Okay.
The problem I have with Rick Rubin, though, is he doesn't really do anything.
Well, but to some extent, that might be all they need. I think Rick Rubin might be the good taskmaster to come in there and make sure they stick to a sound, a style, they get done what they need. I mean, I love what Rick Rubin did with the ZZ Top album that he produced, even Black Sabbath. I mean, he got them into the right frame of mind and got the right sound out of them.
But if you go, because Mike, I probably read some of the same publications you do on when it comes to that stuff. All the artists say the same thing at the end of the day. So what did he do? Well, nothing. He just kind of talked to us.
But you know, I think artists will say that a lot about their producers. I mean,
well, yeah, I don't know if the artists even know what they do.
Well, that's how come I go back, and when I say Mutt Lange for my choice, I don't mean the hysteria Def Leppard Mutt Lange. I'm talking the high and dry Mutt Lange. I'm talking the back in black Mutt Lange. I always thought he'd work great with Kiss because if you go back to AC/DC and you listen to Power Age and then you listen to Highway to Hell, if you don't notice the sonic difference, not only the drums, but the choruses, that's all Rick Rubin, or excuse me, that's all Mutt Lange.
I think Mutt would be great.
All that he would have, Kiss should have dragged him into the studio for Creatures of the Night. Not that I don't love Creatures of the Night and how it is, but at that time, he was the magic man, and he had just the ability to bring choruses out. If you want to go more into what he actually does, there's a great AC/DC book where he literally sits Bond down. And, you know, if you guys don't know, too, if you listen to Back in Black and For Those About to Rock, listen to the background vocals because a lot of that was Mutt. He sings, too. Then if you go listen to the choruses on, say, Flick of the Switch, you can really bookend it. Go to Power Age and then go to Flick of the Switch, and you'll notice something's noticeably different in the drum sound and in the choruses, and that's all Mutt. Kiss would have benefited hugely by that in the early 80s.
You know, it's granted we're supposed to talk about producers they haven't worked with, but I do think it would be pretty cool if they worked with Michael James Jackson again.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
He had two albums he did are pretty stellar.
Yeah.
It's the guitar player.
Nah.
Oh, you mean Rick Derringer?
Hell. All right, bring Michael James Jackson and let Vinny come back and play the guitars, and we can have a whole nother episode about did Vinny save Kiss again.
Oh, we can ride for another year.
Just the way it is now. I don't want to change anything. It's great the way it is. The last two records rule.
They need a producer.
Rolling,
they need a producer. Tommy, what do you think?
I would. I'm tied with two. One, I'm going to say it again, Butch Vig, because I just think the guys in Garbage are just masterful at the sound, the sonic sound of their CDs. Every single one of them, they're all different, yet the sound is just overwhelmingly, and it's so full and rich. Or our buddy Bren. I would love to see Bren take a stab at that, because I think he could help him not only from the writing end of it, but just the way a Kiss record should sound.
I you know what? Yeah, I know who I would love, but at this point, I would love it if anybody just came in and produced it. I think they need a producer, and I don't care who it is really at this point.
But it's got to be someone.
They just need that fifth set of ears, the somebody who can just tweak it just a little bit more, polish it a little bit more. That's what was missing from the last two albums to make them like awesome, great Kiss albums.
Yeah, I agree. All right, so let's move on. This is for all four of us. If out of the blue you got in, and I'm sorry, this is from Michael Igor. Fatrell? Maybe? I'm not sure how you pronounce it, so I apologize, Michael. If out of the blue you got an invite to dinner with any member past or present of KISS, and they told you that you could ask them anything about KISS that you have always wanted to know, who would you choose, and what would you ask them? Mark, you want to go first?
You know what? I don't want to, God,
do you need more time?
Yeah, because my initial question is, you know what, I'm just going to do it.
Okay.
It would be Eric Carr, and it would be, did they cancel your insurance? That's pretty somber.
Worms.
That's going to make a crappy dinner discussion, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, you said if I could bring, if I could talk to anyone from KISS, past or present, and I could ask them one question, because I've heard conflicting from people in the know. Just
from people
who do know.
I've heard.
And they both told me different stories. They both told me different stories.
If he told you what you didn't want to hear, would you be prepared for that?
Yes, because the premise of the one time, of the one angle, was we did because it didn't matter. It was a business decision. And it made sense. If you know somebody is, you know, why it's a waste of, you're just doing it to do it. It doesn't make any sense. It's throwing money out the window. And that's not being unhuman or, you know, inhumane. If you knew, just, you know, if you knew that your father was going to die the next tomorrow and his insurance was due by midnight and you knew he was dying tomorrow and it was going to cost you, you know, $10,000, would you spend it? I mean, I'm talking absolutes. You absolutely knew he was dying tomorrow and your policy was up at midnight and he was going to die at 5 o'clock tomorrow morning. And your policy was due by 12:01, and it's $10,000. Would you do it? I think your father would tell you not to do it because it'd be a waste of money. That's that. Those are tough business decisions that people sometimes have to make. And I always tell people and stuff like this. Guess what? Puppies get hit by cars. It's not a fair world. You know what I mean? There's
what?
Yes.
When?
Sorry.
You know that's my point. So hey, look, this is what this episode is about. You're asking. I wasn't going to answer that, but you know what? You guys deserve honesty from us, and I just told you that I would sit down with, if I could have anybody, be Eric Carr. Did they or did they not? You know more than anyone. Did they cancel your insurance?
Why would you not answer that? That's a great question. I think it's a great question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because, like you said, there's conflicting stories about it, and I think we've probably heard them from the same people. That's a great question.
So, what do you think, Lisa?
It was a toss up between Eric Carr. I think I would sit down with Peter Criss and ask him exactly what happened. Did he quit? That they let him go, and what went down in that boardroom. That's what I would ask.
You don't have a document that tells us what happened in that boardroom?
Not yet. But that's what I'm really curious about. I want to know what happened, because, again, it's conflicting stories. He quit, we let him go, and I think that's one of the – I'd love to know that.
Okay. Michael?
Probably Paul Stanley. And I don't know. There's a lot of interesting things I'd like to ask. But maybe it would be like, in the 80s, how close was KISS to ending? How close were you to quitting KISS and becoming the Paul Stanley Band?
Yeah.
I mean, was your solo tour that last step before you said, you know what, I might be ready to pull the plug on this?
Yeah, that would be interesting. You know, because you had to kind of think at some point, or more than one point during that whole run in the 80s.
Did that thought at least go through your mind as you were dealing with your partner leaving? Did you ever stop and sit down personally and go, you know, should I quit? Should I leave? Is this over? You know, we all know from his book and everything else where he talks about the tension between them, but personally, you know, how deep did it go for Paul?
Right.
Tommy, what's your
oh God, you know, there's just so many. I guess I would say Paul, but I can't think of a specific question. I would just, it would, for me, it would just be more of a conversation. I can't, there's not one specific thing that I want to know that I don't know or haven't heard about. So it would just be, who would be the one person that sitting down to have a meal with would be the one who I would find to be the most fascinating, you know? And I shouldn't say it that way, but just, yeah, I'm curious about that more than anything else. It's just the dinner aspect of it rather than a specific question.
Well, you know, I'm lucky because I know I shared this with you guys before. I've actually been invited and had dinner with them twice. Once lunch, once dinner.
Of course you have.
And it was really cool. It was a lot of fun. I got to take this. My daughter's calling me. So.
Okay.
Continue on.
Continue right. Without Mark.
Okay. So then, okay, well, the next question I was going to ask was kind of like one for Mark in a way. So we'll find something different then. Brian Bazaar asks, what stage set and or costumes would you like to see live again?
Lisa?
You're going to laugh, but I love the Dynasty tour.
Oh,
I love the stage and I love the costumes. I thought that when they came out of the floor with those lights and in that pose, that just blew me away. I loved it. It was over the top, and the costumes, I know the costumes are over the top, but that is my that's my very favorite, ultimate favorite.
Mine's a toss-up between the Creatures of the Night stage and costume and the Revenge stage and costumes. Because okay. Let's put it this way. For costumes and makeup, Creatures of the Night, I think, was great. And I think Gene looked... It's funny. I was talking to somebody about this, I don't know, a while ago on Facebook, how for Creatures of the Night, Gene didn't look as much like a demon. He looked more like a warrior.
Yeah.
If that makes sense to you. Mm-hmm. He looked like a battle warrior in his Creatures of the Night costume. Where all of his other costumes were more demonic, like he was a creature. And I loved the creature's costume for Gene. I just think he looked so badass. And people will probably laugh, but I think Paul looked great. I love the tail. I love the sports bra people would say that he used to wear. You know, I thought
it was a man's ear.
I thought it was actually cool. It was very cool that Paul in that costume wore a piece of real clothing. Up until that point, it was always costumes.
Yeah.
It was always something, you know, something created, something amazing. And all of a sudden, he was like, he wore this cut-off KISS t-shirt, a Creature of the Night t-shirt, many shows. It was like, that was a connection that he's actually a real person. If that makes sense. So I thought that was cool. I loved his boots. I loved his costume. Felt more streamlined, more simple. But you know, the Revenge was badass as well. I mean, the whole stage looked great. Statue of Liberty at the end flipping you off was great. The black leather, you know, it was just like, that was so cool. Now I don't know how well they would look wearing that type of clothing now in their physical conditions. Paul probably would look great.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure about Gene. He's got to stuff a lot of stuff into some black leather.
The spandex is more like a Spanx.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, so might not work as well for Gene.
They were not manufactured for cankles.
No. You know, I think Eric and Tommy would look great in a Revenge style costume. So I mean, those are my answers.
Okay. I'd have to say I'd go with Lisa on the Dynasty outfits. I would really like to see that, but I'm torn between that and, like we discussed in a few weeks back, I would love to see the Destroyer stage rebuilt.
Exactly.
You know. I'm back, by the way.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, welcome back.
Should we let Mark answer this question?
It doesn't bother me.
I don't know.
No. Screw him.
All right. All right. So next question then.
It's my show. Screw him.
Yeah. Yeah, you're wearing the shirt. Keith Combs, have any of you ever received...
Who's sitting on the throne this week, huh? Who's sitting on the throne?
That is kryptonite to my Superman, let me tell you.
Hey, do I need to make another one of these and put Lisa in one of these?
I'm not on. Oh, that's right, because Mitch is on there.
Yeah, you know, I'll replace Mitch and we'll put Lisa on.
God, that's awesome. Make sure I'm the one with the big boobs, though, please.
Yeah, make them like 44 double D's.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Do you want Mark's boobs?
Yes. Look how perky. Look. See? That's awesome. Wait, pull it up a little bit more. There. Yeah.
Just, all right. Well,
that's so disturbing on so many levels.
Well, I'll get with our resident graphic artist Criss, and we'll swap some heads around, and we'll put Lisa where Mark is, so Lisa's got Mark's boobs.
Perfect.
Lisa's gonna look like she's lost at sea with two beach balls.
Oh.
I'll float well.
All right. So Keith Combs wants to know, have any of you ever received a memorable KISS-related gift from a friend or family member?
From a friend or family member?
Can I go first?
Sure.
Huh? Normally, you know what I would answer, I bet, if I ever saw it, would be a doormat.
or a stocking cap.
Yeah, yeah, a skull.
Scully, that would be quite memorable.
But
just the memory of it.
You should have went on the KISS cruise. I was given away on the KISS cruise.
Tommy,
where
just
the hell were you?
Just the memory of it actually arriving on your doorstep would be quite memorable.
Yeah,
I had a whole bag full of those toques. Where the hell were you? Fast Times. I had 30 pair last week. Where were you?
I was this close to working at 7-Eleven. All right, so rest of you guys.
Mark?
I have to think.
Yeah, sure. I mean, this was just kind of weird. My parents went to Italy. This would have been early 90s. And everybody came back with, you know, my parents got, you know, stuff for everybody. And my mom comes back. There was a magazine with Gene Simmons on the cover from Italy.
She was thinking of you. See?
And I was happier than hell. She's like, you know, I was telling your father, he doesn't want that other crap. This is what he wants. And she was 100% right.
Most people bring back rosaries blessed from the Pope, Marcus, the Gene Simmons magazine.
Give the kid what he wants. Give the kid his puffer. If you've ever seen Hollywood Nights, give the kid his puffer.
Lisa? Oh,
I don't... I'd say probably my KISS dolls. And because of the story that my parents had to wait outside of stores to get them, and I know they had to go to like four different stores, and... Peter was sold out, and they really went to big extremes to get these dolls for me. And I know that that was like their big, that was like the main goal, was to get me these KISS dolls, and they went through hell and high water to get them for me. So I'd say that's probably my most memorable KISS item, just because of the story behind it and the lengths they went through just for these KISS dolls. I mean, trust me, every time when I would pull them out, oh, your father and I, we waited in line at Gimbel's for 3 hours, and this whole big elaborate story about how they had to wait for the dolls. Like, thanks.
I love it.
Like, don't, you know, So that, I think that's why I those are my most prized, because of the story and the love behind them and how determined they were to get them for me. So
that's very cool.
I say that.
For me, there's probably two things. The first item, just, it was very obvious. It's when my mom gave me Rock and Roll Over as my first KISS record. I mean, that was just memorable. I mean, just everything changed after she gave me that record. And the second item was in the early 90s, when I was living in Chicago, a coworker who I was good friends with knew I was a KISS fan, and one day he came in and gave me an original KISS lunchbox, mint condition.
Wow.
He's like, yep. I don't need this. Here, you can have it.
And thermos intact? Like, thermos too?
No, no thermos. But you know, I had another thermos already that was part of a very beat-up, rusty lunchbox. So
nice.
I ended up, you know, having basically a mint set, which that was pretty cool that somebody would do that. I didn't tell him what it was worth.
Why would you at that point?
I could fill a notebook with stuff that people gave me that, you know what I mean, KISS-wise. Actually, a lot. It's funny that when you said that, Mike, a friend of mine who in the early 90s, my buddy's nephew was working doing, you know, what's the job when you just go and you hang out posters at the Polygram just sends you out to hang out posters at all the music stores and stuff. Anyways, yes, making a long story, but he came over to me and he brought me the Hot in the Shade
pyramid,
the paper with the Forever one with the. Yep. He's like, this was sitting in my boss's office. He was going to throw it away. He goes, oh, my friend likes KISS. Can I have it? And he gave it to him.
Wow.
And you know how impossible those are to find. I got mine in the little white box with the Forever sticker on it, mint in box. And
I've never seen that. Where is it? Can I see it? Will you get it?
All joking aside, I would, but it's in my display case, and I'd have to take it out. And I don't feel like, because we don't have a lot of time today.
But in the future, will you? Because I've never seen that. I'm not. I'm actually not yanking your chain. And I want to answer this actually on a serious note. I would say there was a guy that worked at Polygram here locally. His name was Mark. Really nice guy. He gave me the passes to get on the Intrepid.
Oh, wow.
What was Mark's last name?
I don't remember. It was so long ago. It feels like a lifetime ago.
There was a Polygram guy that gave me my passes in Pittsburgh. Mark something.
No, he was local and stayed here. So okay. I don't. Well, yeah, so probably there a different person.
There was a guy in Pittsburgh, a label guy in Pittsburgh named Mark, who gave me my passes.
Okay.
Interesting.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So here's an interesting one. Mike Forrest, would KISS have been able to make the comeback in the 1980s that they did if they had kept the makeup on? So I think what he's asking you is, if they would have stayed with the makeup throughout the whole 80s period, could they have brought Ace and Peter back in 96 and had as successful a reunion as they did?
That's an interesting question. I think it would have been big. I don't think it would have been as big, because the makeup would. Part of the reason 96 was so big is it was the return of Ace and Peter and the makeup.
Yep.
If the makeup had stayed throughout the 80s, it would have, that part of the excitement wouldn't be there. It would have just been Ace and Peter. So, again, I think there would have been a level of success. It wouldn't have been the massive blowout that 96 was. Mark.
Well, you just nailed it, Mike. You know, that's pretty much, I think, how that would have went down. You know, I've not much to add.
Okay. All right. Well, then let's move on to the next one. Tom Tobin asks, my questions are this, because it's kind of a two-parter. What if the music from The Elder was very successful? How far do you think KISS would have taken it? I think they would have to have scrambled to have a movie accompany it and maybe a part two album. What were your thoughts? Do you think that they would have continued in that direction? If it would have, let's say that the KISS music from The Elder don't know, exploded like the wall, how would that have changed things?
Well, I think it's pretty obvious if it had exploded, KISS and the label and management, everybody would be like, keep doing the same thing. Don't change.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, be a part 10 by now. Are you kidding me?
You know, do it again. Do it again. Let's milk it. Let's milk it. Let's milk it. So, yeah, I mean, they would have taken it for everything they could.
I think it would have went. I think it would have had a movie and a comic book. I don't know if it would have went as. I don't think it would have went as far as years. You know, I think it might be. They probably would have merchandised it and put merchandise with it, and a movie and a comic book, maybe a part two. But I don't know if it would have gone that far. I don't know. I don't think it would have gone as far as keep going and going and going.
Lisa, there'd be a cruise theme developed around it by now if it was successful. That's KISS. It's what they do. If it was the wall part two, we'd never hear the freaking end of it.
But do you think it would go for 10 years, or do you think it would just be like part two and then, you know, I don't
two
know.
Two words. Really, you know what? They'd milk it for everything they could. And, you know, if it was as successful as the wall, they would have, I think.
And let's remember, back then, the label was heavily influencing KISS because things were not going great. So if the Elder had taken off, I'm sure the label would have been insisting, do this more. Do more of this. Keep doing this. Until the bottom fell out, and then they would be saying, go back to what you were.
Right.
Keep in mind, if that was true, if taking that being successful, it would have changed everything. Now, hear me out. KISS in 1981, 82 couldn't get arrested. Now, had it taken off like the wall was on the radio every 30 seconds. So if you're equaling music from, you know, whatever, you know, music from the Elder is as successful as the wall, well, they would have gained a whole new different fan base. You know what I mean? They wouldn't have been uncool. It would have changed everything.
They probably wouldn't have taken the makeup off.
Correct. That's my point, Michael. It would have changed everything had the trajectory been the same as the wall.
Yep.
Okay. Moving on, Matt CC, staying with the Elder. If I was the opening single to the Elder, do you think the sales would have made it a gold album? Maybe we would have gotten to see the Elder tour. Has the Elder even gone gold at this point? So lots of what ifs on that one.
The answer is no. I mean, the label hearing the whole album pulled the plug. It didn't matter what the first single was.
That was dead on arrival. Dead on arrival.
Yep.
Because they didn't know what to do with it. You know, and the thing is I think that it doesn't matter what they would have put out at that point. I think that the public had cooled on them considerably because it's like anything else. There's overexposure. It just gets to the point where they needed to take a break for a while.
But that goes back to my producer issue. This is a what if, everyone says, what if KISS didn't do the, you know, the pop sound? What if they would have stayed the hard rock juggernaut? I still say, had they gone back and used like a Mutt Lange and played KISS 70s style KISS hard rock, I think they would have. I don't think they would have sunk as low as they did popularity wise. That's just my opinion. Lisa, what do you think?
I think it goes back to the changes. You know, no one likes changes. I think they were trying to go with the flow and trying to. Go with new avenues, kind of like with the what's it called, I Was Made for Loving You. You know, why did they put that why did they do that? Because that was what that was trending during the time. They always try to fit in with the trends. I don't know.
Well, that was the start of them jumping on trends,
right? That's what I mean.
Because they hadn't.
No, they haven't until the disco song, and then they started. You could see they were going down a a certain path. I like The Altar. I thought it was a great album. There were some songs on there that were awesome. But I don't know. I think they were trying too hard to be trendy and not true to themselves.
Yeah, which is always a mistake. Mm-hmm. You know, because I always felt like that word relevance is such a small window. Because if you're a rock band coming out today, like the Rival Sons, are they supposed to produce something that Beyonce would put out because that's considered relevant? Mm-hmm. You know, I just think they chased it too much. And The Elder was just a mistake. I like the record. There's some great stuff on it. But overall, they should have just stayed with the rock and roll part, I think.
Well, it's kind of too concept-y, I think. Again, you know, Alice Cooper comes out with concept albums and is successful. I think KISS try to bank on that and try to capitalize, but maybe it wasn't really good for them.
Well, I think it was the way it was done, too. You know, like if you look at Pink Floyd, The Wall, for instance, okay, that was a concept record, as was probably Dark Side of the Moon, and they put it together for what they were, and it made sense. The Alice Cooper from the inside made sense to me because he was telling the story about himself. The Elder is talking about a boy that, and look at the cover of the record, and there's no photos of the band. They didn't use their image at all to sell the whole idea. They went so out of left field, it could have been Alan Parsons' project who released the record.
Right.
It's not like it was a concept album about the KISS characters,
which that would have been probably really cool.
I mean, could you imagine taking God of Thunder and building a concept album around that?
Or I'm just the character, just or the Talisman. You could have taken and told the story of the characters itself. At least would have been.
At least that's something, you know, KISS fans might have been able to grab onto.
Yeah, relate to.
But look, it was such a sinking ship at that point.
Look, put your hand in my pocket, grab onto my rocket. That's what I want KISS to do.
Yeah.
That's how I want them to sound.
Well,
I want them to play
what you
rock
want KISS to do to you after hours is between you and KISS.
Yeah, I'm just saying.
See that lyric there, Mark?
You know what?
That's the question you would ask.
Yeah, that lyric says a lot about Mark.
That opening line to take me says all you need to know about KISS. That's what I want them to do. I want them to play loud rock and roll. I don't want concept albums. I don't want whatever that garbage was. Just get up, like you said, Michael, rock and roll over.
Just get up and play the Alive album for the 12 millionth time.
Get up and get your grandma out of here. That's what I want. Not, I am just a boy. Look, man, don't get me wrong. I like The Elder, too. But that's not what I want. That's not what they're about. That's not why I collected all this stuff. I want rock.
Tell us how you feel, Mark.
That's it.
Tell us how you feel.
You want what?
Rock. I know what you thought you heard. He said rock, though.
Well, I just, it was Mark talking. I'm like, okay. All right, let's move on. 4 for 4 for Byron Salzano. He's been on almost all the other ones, or all the other ones. What KISS demos have you heard that you wish made a specific album, and what song would you pull from that album to fit it on there? I don't think the second part is as important as the first part. What's a, you know, in the respect of, you know, because it's too hard to say what you maybe would pull off, I don't know, but each one of you, give me a specific demo.
Can I do it? I'll go first.
Yeah,
I want Peter Criss doing None of Your Business from Destroyer, and we take off Great Expectation.
Okay.
Are you guys familiar with the None of Your Business, which I think Detective ended up recording and releasing? Songs semi-similar. But yeah, I always liked that demo of Peter Criss singing None of Your Business, and I would have rather have had that on than Great Expectations.
Okay. Michael?
I'm not a big demo aficionado, so I really couldn't rattle it off. Off the top of my head here, I'll say Sword and Stone.
I swear to God, I knew you were going to say
that. I was just like, okay. I mean, because I like the way that ended up, I think it was Mike Reno who did it. It sounded great. But honestly, you know, yeah, I've got a lot of the tapes with all the demos, but I probably listen to them once, and then I never pay attention to the demos again.
Okay. Fair enough. Lisa?
Don't You Hesitate. That's the one I like. And I would take off. Okay. It's a song that doesn't, it does, that song wouldn't fit on the album. No, I can't say that because it doesn't fit on the album. Give me a second to think about which song I would replace it
okay,
with.
Okay, well,
move on, Tommy.
All right, well, I'll say that.
Which one would you want?
Catch Me When I Fall, which a lot of people think is audio video, the Ace Frehley song. That's the one I would most love to hear recorded. I don't care what album it ends up on.
That's a good one.
I love that song. You know, and I'm much like Michael in the respect that I've heard a lot of the demos maybe once, and then that's about it for me. I don't go over them time and time again.
I can't think of the song I have to replace. So.
All right.
Okay. Well, that could be part of the homework. All right. Scott Graham, in your opinion, even though I love both albums, would Unmasked and Crazy Nights be essential KISS albums with a revenge-type production? This is for myself and Mark, but I think all of us should answer that.
Would
say yes.
Would they be essential KISS albums if they had revenge-style production done to them?
Yes. Yes, 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 yes. I love the songs on both of those records. My issue with Crazy Nights, again, is I think the production is horrid. And Unmasked, the production is horrid because I hate keyboards. And I'd like to see it more of a as a rock record. Bueller?
Mark?
Oh, Bueller. Is it my turn? I've been like jumping on these first just because I'm Shady Kathy, but... So trying to let you guys go. But, oh, no, I think song... Look, I see, because Unmasked isn't horribly produced. It's just, it's a pop record. It doesn't sound like KISS. And I go back to the, could any of those songs have been on Rock and Roll Over? I don't think so. I don't think Torpedo Girl would have fit on Rock and Roll Over. I think it's a wholesale thing. The songs were different. The production was different. It those songs don't play well into being a hard rock album to me. So is that kind of answering the question well enough?
You waiting for someone else, Tommy, or are we done?
Thinking.
No, I'm waiting on Lisa.
I agree. I don't think that those songs would fit in that rock and roll style. I don't know. Unmasked is one of my favorite albums. Crazy Nights, I can take it or leave it, but I don't think it would fit in a revenge in that style. I just don't. I like the idea of it being poppy. That's what I liked about Unmasked.
Okay.
Yeah, but they're asking, do you think that would have made it better with that kind of production?
No.
My argument was the songs weren't written to be complimented.
I mean, you would have to change everything. Meaning you couldn't still use the same producer and then just have revenge-style production. You need to get a completely different producer. You need to have different studio. You have to have a different mindset. You have to have... That changes everything. So, you know, and I think what we've all said, many of us have said, is we'd love to have heard Unmasked as a heavy album, but that's not just saying... Removing keyboards doesn't make that happen.
Well, to be fair, Michael, now some songs would work that way. Is that you would work with revenge style? I mean, it's just a really basic rock song.
But
whereas something like Shandy, I'm just thinking, you take the original, the way it was played and everything, you could have made that song. But the record as a whole, no, because the songs weren't rocks, hard rock songs.
But that goes back to a producer. You know, a producer might have had Torpedo Girl come in and totally change that song and made it into a KISS song. Might have said, we're only using this one line, and the rest of the song, 90% of the song gets thrown away, but this one line is what we build off of, because it's the producer who sets a lot of the tone and the direction.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I'm correct, looking at it just... Well, and I'm looking at it from the standpoint of not so much it being a heavier metal type record. I'm just looking at it like if I had the opportunity, I would have beefed up the guitars, removed the keyboards completely, and given a thicker drum sound to it. So even if it sounded like the production of The Elder, I think that on mass would be considerably different and really cool. So well, it doesn't... Sorry,
the Elder has a decent drum sound. And if you listen to the guitars at the beginning of the Oath, they're nice and crunchy and up in there. But then you listen to them, you know, further down the record, they don't have that grit to them. You know what I mean? You could tell they didn't record that whole record at one time in one studio. You can tell there's certain records you can just tell just this song doesn't match the sonics of the other one, because the minute you move a microphone, it's over. You know, you're not going to get that same sound. So,
all right, moving on. Scott Eric McClure. If Creatures of... Okay, wait a minute. I'm sorry. Okay, let me see. I lost track. Okay, where are we here? David Montgomery. Now, I want to ask this question, and I want it... We got to be respectful here, because he's just asking for an answer, and we've debated this a little bit in the past, all right? So David Montgomery, why do KISS fans have to pay to meet KISS after we've been paying for 40 years to go to the concerts and buy the albums and CDs and T-shirts and hats and stuff?
Because it's a transaction, because there's supply and demand, because paying in, buying other products doesn't buy you interest in something in the future. I've been buying milk my entire life. Does that mean I deserve to have an entire farm free now? No.
Hey, you've been paying 40 years, right?
I've been paying milk. Listen, I've been paying, we've all, every single person's been buying toilet paper your entire life. Do we deserve to own a paper factory? Because we've been paying in toilet paper?
That answers that question perfectly.
Yep, that was good, Mike.
Okay. All right.
You're entitled to what you buy, no more.
That's yep. Right. Yeah, and I just, it's one of those things where that's the trend now. You can still try and meet KISS. I mean, you could go stand outside the hotel, just like the old-fashioned way, and get them to sign something. I'm sure that if they're passing you in the lobby, they would sign something for you or take a photo, would they not?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I mean, look at the Crazy Bastard, you know?
Yeah. I mean, but it comes down to if you what is your time worth? Because it's not you're going to have to invest time to find out where they're staying, when they're going to be there. You might have to go camp in the lobby of a hotel for 8 hours for that 2-minute opportunity to meet them. That 8 hours of time, is that worth something to you? Could you have been doing something else? Could you have been earning a living? And a lot of people, myself, will justifiably say, you know what? It's worth spending $250 to go meet Cheap Trick or $1,000 to meet KISS or whoever that artist is, because you know what? I don't have to take time out of my life to do this. I just show up and I'm treated like royalty.
And you know what? They're never short on, not like they're trying to fill in the gaps or fill in spots. Every time I see those backstage packages, they're packed. They're always full. So obviously the demand is there. People aren't, you know, they're not saying, well, I don't want to spend the money. Every time they're packed to the gills with those meet and greet packages. So, you know, they're not hurting. And people aren't saying, well, I don't want to spend the money.
But it's not an impossibility. You can go and meet them.
Yep.
You know? And also, too, if it was free, how in the hell would they ever get out? Mm-hmm. I mean, look at what happened to them at the convention tour.
Well, that was, you know, part of the original rationale was, okay, we literally could only do 25 meet and greets with the band in a 30-minute time period. And if they were free, you would have 200 people lining up. You'd have 2,000 people lining up to do it. So how do you pick the 25 that get in and the rest that don't, and you're going to have 1,000 people pissed off that they waited in line for 3 hours and they couldn't get in?
Yep. And just as a side note, too, if you go backstage as a guest and you're not a paying meet and greet person, there's chances you won't get to meet them.
Oh, yes.
Because they care about their they care about those people that paid and took that time out than they do guests.
Well, I can guarantee even if you are a guest backstage and you get a chance to meet them, you're not going to get the amount of time and the quality interaction that you'll get.
And that's okay.
From a meet and greet.
And that's okay. Because those people paid that money.
But the point is no matter what, it's not that it's like you can't do it. You can still meet them in many different ways. You can go to one of the Rock and Brews openings. You can, I mean, there's so many.
Oh yeah,
you know.
Gene and Paul do public appearances. It seems like every frickin' week one of them is somewhere.
Right. I mean, it can't be that hard.
It's work.
You know?
It's work.
You're right.
Yeah. You know, but it's still doable. Because, you know, we were at we were at the hotel where the Rolling Stones were staying, and they were signing crap for people, you know. So, I mean, they're the biggest band in the world. So it's possible. It can be done. All right. So anything else to say on that?
Nope.
Okay. John Jeremiah wants to know, what if Tommy Thayer and Eric Singer did their own solo albums at some point? How do you think the reception would go for that?
I don't think anybody would care.
I mean, no one cared about the Gene Simmons solo record.
Yeah, exactly. Nobody cared about the Asshole album.
Right.
I mean, yeah, they're not names in that level. And you add to it the disaster that the music industry is in right now, nobody would care.
Right. It's true.
Well, I mean, there's always going to be, like, you know, Eric does the ESP. Bruce Kulick still releases records, which is what I, you know, to sync back to the last show, all the kidding aside, had Vinny kept his wits about him, he could have still been putting out new music. And you can still put music out. Michael, correct me if I'm wrong, has there been one or two platinum records this year? And I'm talking of all genres of music.
I don't know if it was this year or last year. It was like the Frozen movie soundtrack and Taylor Swift, I think, last year.
And now Adele this year.
Yeah.
That's about it. Well, and it has nothing to do with Tommy or Eric. That's just, like you said, the state of the music industry. It doesn't matter who it is that puts out a release. It's changed.
Listen, Keith Richards released a solo album this year, and I bet that's not even close to being gold.
No.
Now, keep in mind, too, it goes back to what we were talking about earlier. The last Aerosmith record, they went back and got Jack Douglas, which is the equivalent of Kiss going back and getting Eddie Kramer to try and revive the band, and they didn't come anywhere near platinum. I don't even think it went. Did it go gold?
I don't know.
The last Aerosmith? I don't think it did. But my point is, those days of the platinum-selling rock albums, Bon Jovi could come and put a new record out right now, and it's not going to go platinum.
Listen, there's four knuckleheads here that would buy it. And there's a few thousand more knuckleheads that will buy it. But beyond that, that's it. And if they're going to do it, they're going to do it because they just want to release music, not because they want to release music and sell it and make a lot of money.
I think those days are over.
They would do it simply because they have the desire to release an album and be creative. That's it.
But we as KISS fans would buy them and support them. But,
right.
You know.
Well, what's true for any band that plays their own music, you get tired of playing. Yeah, you're a musician. You don't want to play the same song over and over and over. If you're a creative type, you want to write new songs. They're your babies. You put them out, and you know you're not going to get to play all of them. Like, you know, much like on even using Kiss as an example, the last two records. You know, they played a handful of them throughout the little tours they did, but you know they didn't play half the record or anything. just, but you know what? I'm sure it made, especially Paul Stanley, made him feel good, made him feel relevant. I got a new record that I put out, and I know it's not going to go, you know, platinum, but it, I'm doing my craft, and that's what you're supposed to do. And as you guys know, I've rallied about this over and over. There's so many older touring bands from Tull and Purple on down who still release new music. You're not going to hear it.
I saw an interview with Tom Peterson the other day because he's got that whole rock your speech thing because his son has autism. And they asked him about Cheap Trick recording. And he said the new record's just about done. And he said, we plan to release a new record every year for the next several years.
And like, I mean, I read an interview like 6 months ago where Cheap Trick said they've actually got two albums almost done and in the can.
I believe it.
Guys, if you love those bands as you're growing up, why stop supporting them?
Right.
I would bet too that the people that watch this show or get into this show do, for the most part. It just, you know, you're not going to hear it on your local rock station, unfortunately.
Yeah.
You know, it's just sad. I tell you what, it's you guys, everybody here knows I'm a big Purple lackey. On the album before this last, the Purple one, they wrote a song called MTV. And they do this whole little skit during the solo break. It's fun. And Ian just says, pretends like he's talking to your classic rock DJ. And he does it with a great humor. They're like, yeah, smoke on the, yeah, that song. You know what I mean? And he just basically says they come to town. They mention that you have a new record. And what do they play? Smoke on the Water.
On the Water.
You know what I mean? They're like, okay, you're here. You're out the door. No.
Right.
You know, it's, they don't even care. So it's like, that's got to be disheartening, you know what I mean, for any artist. But I think as time goes on, from Van Halen on down, you want to put something out eventually. And, you know, Mike, you and I know both loved – it's been a year or two, but that last ZZ Top record was just phenomenal. Yep, sure was.
Okay, move on. Kyle Schneider, what is the one song KISS has never played live that you would want to hear?
Well,
you got all afternoon.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I don't have
one.
The in-depth knowledge to know exactly what songs have never been played. Again, I'm not that type of a fan where I can rattle off the top of my head and go, yeah, I know they've never played this song. You know, they just played this on the cruise, and they played it a couple times during the Destroyer tour. I mean, Flaming Youth was always, as a kid, that was my absolute favorite KISS song, was Flaming Youth. I would love that song.
Mm-hmm. Pizza guy.
Pizza. Just done eating some pizza and learning about Cuba.
Is that mine? Oh my God. Is it mine?
It's our time. Yes. Dude.
Oh my God! I have ice cream men or doorbells ringing.
Okay, so Lisa, do you have one?
I would pick anything for my baby. I love that song. That's a very cool song. I always love the older stuff. I've always loved that song.
That's a good
I would love to hear that one.
Mark, you've got 10 seconds. That's all the time we're giving you to answer this.
That's easy. Danger off.
I'm sorry, you broke up.
Danger off a Creature.
Oh, okay. All right.
I love that song.
Yeah. My choice would be Larger Than Life.
Oh, that's a good one.
Mm-hmm. Hey, or Mr. Speed.
Dead Daisies did Larger Than Life on the boat, and it just was awesome.
Yeah, that's
awesome.
A good set. Yeah, that would be my choice.
Hey, Mark, KISS Cruise 6 announced today, I think it's Cozumel.
Really?
Yes.
Not Cuba? Or Jamaica? Mm-hmm. Or?
So I saw somebody post on Facebook a bunch of screen captures that they posted, like, the schedule, part of the schedules, and one day is going to be in Cozumel.
Hold on, I'll go to my email.
Because I will be attending that cruise this
year. I'm not saying it's not. But I mean, I, you know. We went to Cozumel once. We went to Cozumel because of Superstorm Sandy. Say that 10 times real fast. You know, that's how come we went there. What's that?
I didn't see any updates about the next KISS cruise. Wasn't that? I don't know.
Yeah.
Tommy, continue on while these two are.
Okay, so Todd Menard, for each of you, what do you feel has been KISS's greatest misstep?
Wow.
Well, there's two ways you can look at this. Or I'll say there's two ways I would look at this. I could list missteps and say it's jumping on trends. But you could also have a philosophy in everything they did got them to the point where they are today.
Mm-hmm.
And if they, going back to the Elder, if they had not done the Elder, we may not have ever gotten Creatures of the Night. Maybe the band broke up. Maybe the album they did instead of the Elder flopped even worse and the band broke up. You know, it's one of those, like Star Trek, do you go back and mess with time? Because if you step on an ant, it kills your entire family that you didn't know about. You know, it's one of those strange things. So I would say there's nothing that I would say don't do it, because we got KISS 45 years later now because of everything they did. If you were to say what were some of the things that were the most head-scratching, I would go, well, you know, that whole Dynasty Unmasked period was like a big what the F are you doing? But that got a, I think that kicked them in the ass is what that did.
I would say, who's up next? Lisa, do you know what you're going to say?
Yeah, Tom, you go. You never
Well, I was just going to say, for me, it was the over-merchandising, because they've done it twice. Not only in the late 70s, which I think it created a problem, they did it again. It's interesting how everything kind of went full circle. So the biggest misstep for me, aside from the merchandising, was they well, maybe it's beyond their control, I don't know, but it seemed to me that they allowed themselves to repeat history once the reunion tour started again. It's almost like it was the same type of events that happened that led up to the demise of the
original tour. Yeah, but let me throw it to you this way. If you were in the last 10 years of your career, 20 years of your career, and people all of a sudden started lining up to throw you tens of thousands of dollars for separate deals, and you know that you're repeating the same mistake again, but hell, we're not going to be here in 20 years. Things are going to be, you know, it's the twilight of our career. Would you turn it away? And then what are you showing us, Mark?
It's there. There's the KISS cruise.
Just doesn't say anything. It just says they're leaving from Miami. That's it.
Somebody posted a screen capture of something that showed on this day it's this, on this day it's that, on this day it's this. But anyway, you know, I don't know. I lost my train of thought now.
You were talking about...
It was derailed?
Yeah.
Yeah. You were talking about the if you someone...
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, I sort of don't blame them for the merchandising. I mean... You know, they padded their pockets and they realized it's not like they were going to destroy their career because their career was in its twilight.
But in the same time, you have to remember that in the 70s, they over-merchandised, but now they're coming to a whole new group of people. People that did not know all that from the 70s. So they're introducing themselves in the reunion tour to a whole new group of people who probably don't have any kind of merchandise. So now this new group of people who are maybe seeing KISS for the first time in makeup are going to gobble up all that. I think this time around,
they're also deliberately going after children. Mm-hmm. Where, you know,
their parents are older, going to introduce their children to KISS and makeup, and now it's going to start another cycle.
In 79, they didn't want they didn't want to deliberately go after the kids market. They wanted to still be an older, relevant band. Right. Now they do.
Right. Well, yeah. In fact, that reminds me of a story I was going to share with you guys. I was at Mr. Zero's last week because he's so happy that
you can't mention that name because I haven't gotten my T-shirt yet.
Well, you can bleep it out.
Okay.
Well, you just got to ask. Okay. And so I'm leaving, and there's this gentleman with his daughter. She's probably, I think, probably couldn't have been older than four. Where I'm walking out of the store behind him, and she points at the big Spencer's Kiss dolls, and she's like, "Kiss, I like that." As they were walking out, and I said to him, "I'm like, are you a Kiss fan?" He's like, "No." I said, "Well, how does she know?" And he's like, "Scooby-Doo."
Yep, there you go. To me, that's just the way they, you know, coming out.
So you're wrong, Tommy. You are wrong.
Sorry, Tommy.
Did I just prove the point against me? Is that what you're saying?
Your opinion doesn't matter. Next.
Okay, this is the last one.
That's not nice.
That hurt.
That is not nice, Tommy. I apologize.
Oh, no, I don't pay attention to anything he has to say. Look at the freaking shirt he's wearing. He's a narcissist. All right, this is the last one, and then we got to wrap up. Chip Chapin, what if KISS had released Creatures of the Night instead of The Elder? Would Creatures have fared better? KISS promised a hard rock album for 1981. I've always wondered about that.
Well, I think we kind of already discussed that.
Well, I don't know. I didn't recall what our answers were. If they would have just skipped
just
The Elder entirely.
You weren't paying attention to the three of us talking, were you?
I guess. All right. Well, then I guess we're done. So
you don't have one other question you could throw in there?
All right, I will.
I mean, no offense to the guy who asked the question, but I do think we kind of answered that in our Elder discussion.
Oh, okay, here. Jeff Anderson, for each of you, what is your favorite after KISS project band or pre-KISS in Tommy's case?
You mean with members of KISS?
Yeah, so outside of KISS, what band do you like best that a member of KISS has been in?
Totally got that.
Mark.
What band do I like that bad?
What side project? Yeah, okay.
Lisa?
Union. I think they were very underrated. Awesome band.
Let's see. I'm going to say Black and Blue.
Really?
Yeah. I love the debut Black and Blue album. Phenomenal album. Hi, Mrs. Mark.
Hey, Liz.
Hey, we need you to take one for the team.
Oh, what? What?
Yeah, we're trying to
Where's
get the
hell's that?
We're trying to get. we're trying to get. Craig
that's another time.
On. Yeah, that's the after that dark.
Three sides after dark.
Just keep it on the rubber Gene Simmons suit.
yeah, exactly. No, we're trying to get Craig Gass on.
Okay.
So I we showed need him you to reach out to him. We need you to reach out to him.
You put him on the boat because you know you're trying to invoke your celebrity clause.
Yeah, I was.
Nice, hall pass.
I told him the story how we went and saw him, and then he invited us back, and we went, and I gave him a bunch of CDs and stuff. So it was.
Did you give him any picks? He's a huge KISS pick collector.
No, I just gave him a bunch of CDs. He was really into it. He thought it was cool. So, anyways, we'll talk about the. Because that'd be a good guest, I think. I think he'd be number one, to be a lot of fun. And the cruise, man, let me tell you, he was funnier than hell on the cruise. It was.
Hey, Mrs. Mark.
Yeah.
Are those doormats still sitting over there?
Yeah, I'm looking right at them.
Look what I'm looking at.
Mark is not getting this new magazine until doormats arrive.
I'm looking for boxes at work, actually.
They're a bitch to find a box.
Yeah, we know. That was the excuse a couple weeks ago.
What doormat?
Hey, guys, I got birthday plans in about eight
Lisa,
minutes.
Do you know what they're talking about?
No.
Do you want me to show you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I'd love to see it. We haven't even seen these yet.
Yeah.
Bro, I sent you pictures of
No, you didn't.
No, you didn't.
You didn't send a squat.
Nice. I kept them in great shape.
Lisa,
I heard there Christmas, was
Christmas a year ago, Mark was going to send these to us as Christmas presents.
Mark.
Well, there's a shortage of cardboard in Detroit.
You guys
and of course, my idea to make them.
I can't wait to see it.
Oh, my God. How cool. How freaking cool.
It is. They're very cool.
That's awesome.
That's cool.
I'll try and get them off this week. I make no guarantees. It is now about
it is now
7 minutes. In-
yeah.
Oh, my God. All right. All right. I know, right. Let's wrap up. Let's wrap up. Dude, let's come up with a homework. Let's come up with
all
a
right.
homework.
Well, I also want to just say thank you to each and every one of you that submitted a question. We will do another one of these and get to more of your questions in the future.
I
so thank
all
you.
Mine out. I printed all the questions out and read them all.
Wow, did you come prepared? Mark and I didn't know squat.
No.
I printed them out.
Yeah, but I was on time.
Wow.
Lisa, you're in the locker room now.
I would just like to say, as a side note,
you're in the locker room now, Lisa. You're going to get treated like one.
Okay, I can handle that. So I'm good. Anyway, I would like to thank everyone for my birthday wishes the other day. That was very sweet, and I appreciate that. It made my day. And I'm going to see KISS in Oklahoma for my birthday. Thank you.
I'm probably nice. There's a good chance I'm going to be there.
Oh, yay.
Really good chance. So, yeah.
Hey, I want to make a real quick mention. I think we mentioned this briefly at the top of the show, but it's been 3 years. 3 years yesterday since Three Sides of the Coin launched. And thank you. I mean, it's freaking phenomenal that you guys.
Thank you.
Guys,
thank you.
Girls, kids, moms, dads, members of KISS all support us.
I'm very happy to be part of the family. That was a nice birthday wish, and I'm glad that it's going 3 years strong, because this is awesome. It's awesome.
We're looking to a fantastic 2016.
So
we got some cool stuff.
Let's come up with a homework question and wrap up.
Oh, real quick, Tommy, we don't have to say who, but Tommy's been working hard for us. It's all I'm going to say.
Tommy's out there booking acts for us.
Tommy's busting his ass. Wait,
I'm trying. I'm trying. Yeah. Trying to bring you guys some quality stuff. So,
Tommy.
We're
going to surprise you. We were almost talking about should we surprise Mark with that one, you know, just to see the look on your face.
I'm a happy boy.
We tried that once before, and he didn't like surprises.
Yeah.
All right.
So homework question. I don't know. I mean, you know, just why don't you
pick one of the questions that we answered
and answer it yourself.
And answer it yourself. Exactly.
Yeah.
And second homework question, when do you think the floor mats will arrive?
Christmas 2016. Just saying.
Yeah.
God, I hate you guys. And we bring the new kid along and right in my ow! Ow!
I know, she just jumps right in. It's awesome.
Sorry.
Oh God. I love this show. And I don't even watch it.
4 minutes and counting, guys.
Okay.
All right. So you guys know where to go. Leave your comments. Facebook.com/ThreeSidesOfTheCoin. ThreeSidesOfTheCoin.com. YouTube, Spreaker, SoundCloud. We are everywhere. Homework questions. You got it. Go buy a T-shirt. Go buy a hat. 20% off until the end of the year so we can make some new T-shirts next year. That's it. Okay. We're out. Three Sides of the Coin.
Bye. Want to get your official Three Sides of the Coin logo and shocker tee? Now you can. We ship worldwide. Get yours online at shop.threesidesofthecoin.com.
For interviews and media inquiries, contact Izzy at izzypresleyproductions.com.
Download your free copy of the KISS School of Marketing.
11 lessons I learned working with KISS.
The number one downloaded business book on noise trade. Go to books.noisetrade.com/Michael Brandvold.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
you love the show, go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.